Hello. Through this presentation, we shall be doing a very important concept in English grammar called punctuations. Now, there are different types of punctuations and each punctuation has a significance in English grammar. It is used with a purpose and it allows for proper expression of one's own ideas and views. So, let us see what is the concept of punctuations as well as the different types of punctuations through this presentation. Now, the first concept that we are going to do is about punctuations. Now, punctuation, the origin of the word punctuation is from the Latin word called punctuatio, which means a marking with points, as well as punctuare, which means to mark with points or dots. It can also, the origin is from the Latin word punctus, which means to prick or pierce. Now, the meaning otherwise would mean the system of inserting pauses in a written manner. Now, pauses could be long pauses, short pauses, then between the long and the short, okay, the medium pauses. So, all the different types of pauses is happening with the punctuations. Or punctuations also give importance to certain words. So, that also is very important. In any case, what we are going to do is learn about punctuations in general. Now, punctuations means the use of spacing, conventional signs using either space or signs or certain typographical devices as aids to the understanding and correct reading, both silently as well as aloud. So, when you read silently or when you read aloud, it is the punctuations that allow you to read properly with the right expression. Okay, silently and aloud of what text? Handwritten and printed texts. So, punctuations allow us to read properly and to understand anything properly. So, now let's start learning about the different types of punctuations. Okay, so the first one, it is full stop. All right, full stop is also called period. In American language, it's also called period. Now, take a look at the following sentences and see where this is used. The sun rises in the east. Now, this is used at the end of a declarative or an imperative sentence. Declarative is, okay, the sun rises in the east is a declarative sentence. It is a statement that is made. Imperative are command sentences where also they end with a full stop. All right. So, that is to indicate that the sentence is complete. Now, look at the second one. Mr. Harry is a scientist. Now, where do you see a full stop? You see the full stop at the end of a sentence. It is a declarative sentence. But you also see the dot or the puncture or the period after the MR, that is Mr., to indicate a short form of the title. Now, look at the third one. Can you see there a dot, okay, at the end of the sentence, but there is a dot between the numbers. So, 53.8%. So, CIMA secured 53.8. Now, that point is also a full stop, which is indicating a pause. It is indicating decimal numbers. Look at the fourth one. Sweets like barfi, comma, chocolate mousse, comma, etc. Now, etc., etc., etc. is a word. Now, that is made into a short form and a dot is used to indicate that it's an abbreviation. So, it is used for abbreviations. For example, E dot, G dot is for example, MA, Master of Arts, M dot, A dot, okay, MSc, M dot, SC dot. So, these are all abbreviations in which we definitely use the full stop or the dot. Similarly, United Nations, we'll write U dot, N dot, okay. So, to indicate that these are abbreviations. So, full stop has these four uses. The next punctuation that we shall see is the comma. Okay. Now, this comma is a very important punctuation because any mistake in its usage will completely change the meaning of a sentence. Okay. So, we shall see where all it is used, but meanwhile, we'll see what is a comma. Well, a comma is, if you see the concept, let us see the concept, what is a comma. All right. A comma is a shorter pause than a full stop and it denotes a continuing sentence rather than a complete one. Okay. So examples are, now look at other comma, there are a lot of examples, so we'll have to see each one carefully. Let's see the first one. It was raining heavily, so we stayed back. Okay, now these are two main clauses. You can actually see these are two sentences joined by a conjunction so. Alright, so you see here there is a conjunction so which is joining two sentences which can stay separate. Okay, so when you are doing that, you have to show the separation by putting a comma there. Okay, so you have to show that these two are separate sentences. Alright, so you're putting a comma. Now look at the next example. Let's see that. Even here, there are two parts of a sentence. However, if I had written this sentence, he missed the bus though he ran, so then I wouldn't have had to put a comma. But here what is happening is though he ran, it is coming here first, a subordinate or a dependent clause is coming first. Though he ran, he missed the bus. So then we have to put a comma because you're showing a pause. Even when we speak, we say though he ran, he missed the bus. So you see, you can feel the short pause that you use. Okay, so this is though he ran, comma, he missed the bus. But if it was the other way around, he missed the bus though he ran, you needn't have put a comma there. Okay, let's see this next example. Seema, now there's something about Seema, who secured 53.8% was appreciated. Actually, the sentence was Seema was appreciated, but now you want to tell something about Seema. Okay, Seema, who secured 53.8%? Now, this whole clause, this relative clause or adjective clause is about Seema, but it is actually not part of the sentence. So, what you do is you separate this because you want to highlight it. Seema, who secured 53.8%? So, you put a comma there to separate who secured 53.8%. Was appreciated. So when you're breaking a sentence and you're including something which is out of the sentence, then you put a comma to show that this is a highlighted part. Okay, now let's see some more examples of the usage of comma. Well, why don't we concentrate on our work? Okay, now this is, see that these are called discourse markers. Now, well, now listen, now please understand this. When I say now, please understand. So now, comma, please understand. Okay, now what shall we do? Now, okay, comma. All right, because these are discourse markers. All these are words that, okay, you know, before you start something, it's a marker to say, well, I'm starting something and I'm saying something. Okay, so well, now, okay, these are all words that will take a comma after them. Okay, they are called discourse markers. Okay, the next one. She said, now this is a direct speech. I do not understand. Therefore, now whenever there is something different coming, you have to separate with a comma. She said, comma, I do not understand. Here there's a full stop and then close inverted commas. Okay, so this is very important. She said, comma. You're separating this, but this is also very important because inside the full stop comes because the sentence has completed. The full stop comes at the end of the sentence and then close inverted commas. Okay, now this is to indicate the beginning of a direct speech. All right, so she said, what, comma, I do not understand. Now, third one is also about a direct speech. However, see where the comma is. Maria should. See, he said and then there's a comma just like this. Okay, he said and then there's a comma just like she said and then there's a comma. But I want you to notice here, Maria should. See, the sentence has not completed. The sentence has not completed, and to show that this sentence is still not complete, you put a comma. You put a comma here to show that this sentence has not finished. Maria should, he said, comma, complete the work given to her, full stop, close inverted commas. Okay, so you see how important it is to understand the placement of comma. Okay, now the fourth sentence. The event will be on 31st July 2020. Now, can you see here there's a comma after the word July. Now, this is how we use in dates, okay, to separate the day of the month and the year. Alright, now the day of the month is 31st July and the year, because you cannot write 31st July 2020 without this comma. So never make a mistake when you're writing dates in your letter writing or anywhere. Okay, be very careful where that you place the comma after the month, because you have to show a separation. All right. Now, some more examples about comma. Now, can you see there's a list coming up? Plants require what? Air, comma, water, comma, soil, comma, minerals. Now there's no comma. And sunlight. So whenever the word and comes, there is no comma either behind or in front. Okay. Either way, there is no comma whenever there's a word and. But before that, when there's a long list, you have comma, comma, comma to separate items in a list. All right. Next sentence. However, he did not answer the questions. Now, these are adverbials. Okay. However, therefore, moreover, these are words that will now take a comma because you're separating. You're saying, look, however, he did not answer the question. So whenever like this, moreover, therefore, however, consequently, subsequently, etc., you put the comma. It's raining heavily today, comma, isn't it? Now look at this placement of comma here. Here it is because there is a question tag following it, isn't it? So always before a question tag, it will come. Also, please note this in short responses also we use. For example, yes, I am. Yes, comma, I am. So these are short responses. Yes, I am. Okay, to separate. Yes, I am. All right. So there also it is used. Now see here, come Seema, take the reward. Now you want to separate the person. All right. Come Seema, take the reward. All right. So take the reward. Come Seema, comma, take the reward, to separate the name of a person of or group being addressed. You're talking to Seema, so you're actually separating her, you're highlighting her. So come Seema, comma, take the reward. All right. So you've seen the various uses of comma. I think comma is that punctuation which has a lot of use, and therefore you have to be very careful when you place them in a sentence. Okay. So now that we're finished with comma, we go on to our dear question mark. Now, question mark is something that you are all used to. We have all at some point of time attended exams, okay, appeared for exams. And every exam has questions in it. And every question usually has a question mark. Okay, so let's see what is a question mark. Question mark is, of course, all right. It is showing an interrogation. So see where it is used. Where are deserts located? Can you see that? There's a question mark at the end of an interrogative sentence, and it is also used. You can see here, there is a question tag and it is used for a question tag. We just now did that there is a comma before it, but also do not forget that there is a question mark at the end of a question tag. Okay, so these are the only two ways in which a question mark could be used. Now the next one is exclamation mark. Again, exclamation mark will not be used in declarative and interrogative sentences or assertive or imperative sentences. We use them only in exclamatory sentences. Now you see here, this exclamation mark, it expresses sudden emotions or sudden expressions are shown by exclamation marks. Okay, so let's see now where it is used. Okay. How beautiful is the rain? At the end of an exclamatory sentence, to express strong emotions. Okay. Now also we use them for interjections. Now say, hurrah, we won. Alas, we lost him. Okay. Or we lost the race. All right. Hurrah, we won. So these are at the end of interjections also we use. Okay. Interjections. What are interjections? These are words like that express emotions. Hurrah, bravo. Okay. Alas. All right. Oh, for a beautiful horse, you know, so something like this. So these are the places where exclamation marks are used. Now we shall go on to a very important punctuation mark, and that is apostrophe. Apostrophe, comma is written down, but an apostrophe is on top. Now, apostrophe is different from quotation marks, okay, so or inverted commas. Now, apostrophe is something that is very useful for various things. Okay, let us see now where all it is used. Huh? See here. This is Raju's bat. So whose bat is this? Raju's bat. So can you see the apostrophe here? The apostrophe here shows that it is whose bat. Okay, so what is it showing? It is showing possession. Whose bat? Who is possessing the bat? Raju. So Raju's bat. Okay, let's see the next two. This happened in the 90s. Instead of saying 1990s, you say just the 90s, but you put an apostrophe here. Okay. You should cross your T's and dot your I's. Okay, can you see this? T's and I's. All right. So where is it used? It is used with letters and numbers. So sometimes with letters and with numbers also they are used. Let's see the third one. I thought they'd come. They would come. In fact, just imagine WOULD. All WOUL is removed. Just an apostrophe does the function of all of those and a D is used. Okay. I thought they would come. Instead of that, I thought they'd come. See the next sentence. She's running home. She is running home. Apostrophe is indicating that there is one letter missing here. Okay. So it is she is running home. She's running home. Okay. So what is it used for? In contracted forms. Now these are contractions of words. All right. Where they are contracted or reduced in size. Okay. So to show one or more missing letters. See the third one, some more examples. I have not heard from them. So I haven't heard from them. The O is missing. I haven't heard from them. Next sentence, it is a bright day. It is a bright day. The I is missing. T is capital. It is a bright day. Or it is a bright day. Now look here. This is a famous line from the poem Daffodils that floats on high over vales and hills. Over. The V is missing, so O apostrophe ER. So here what you're seeing is the missing words are replaced by the apostrophe. So the apostrophe tells us that there are some missing letters. Sorry, not words, the letters are missing. So apostrophe also shows how the words are contracted. So these are the three main functions. There are some other uses also that you should know about apostrophe. Look at this. First sentence. I gave all the teachers letters. Okay. Now, these are a little special cases that are very important. Of course, it is showing whose letters, but please note here you're not. These are teachers means plural of teachers. You're showing that there are many teachers. So here how it is used is the apostrophe comes after the plural and there is no one more S. It is already showing it is the plural of S. Okay. So it is possession of plurals ending in S. Similarly, now when I want to show that, you know, I'm going to the doctor's dispensary, instead of using another big word, I went to the doctor's on his way. He went to the doctor's on his way. Okay. So doctor's means it's understood that it is a dispensary. So doctor's place. So instead of that, doctor's S apostrophe on his way. See this? They went over to Sachdev's. To Sachdev's. Okay. Now, Sachdev's means at Sachdev's house. To their house. Okay. He went over to Sachdev's for tea. He went over to his house for tea. Alright. So, instead of writing the whole thing, it is showing somebody's workplace or somebody's home. Okay. Now, I read Dickens novels. Whose novels? Now, Charles Dickens has a word is spelt only with an S at the end. His surname only is like Charles Dickens. His name is like that. Okay, S is there. So you cannot say Dickens's novels. All right. So Dickens novels. So you have an apostrophe to indicate that it is his novels. So same, similar like this. But this is not a plural. This is his name that is ending with S. Okay. So you see how now? To show a workplace or a person's place and also to show possession of a name ending in S. Now, these are all unusual cases. These are all special cases and you need to understand them very thoroughly. Okay, so never make mistake of how you write them. So when is apostrophe not used? When it should not be used? And we always have confusion about this. Okay, so when are they not used? See here, not used to form possessive pronouns such as its, yours, and theirs. So we see here that there are possessive pronouns such as its, yours, and theirs. They are possessive pronouns. All right, so we don't make use of apostrophes there, because if you make use of an apostrophe, it will make, become an error. For example, if I say it apostrophe s, it is. It is not its. Okay, so when you use possessive pronouns in any sentence, then you do not make use of apostrophes at all. Okay, in those words, in those possessive pronouns. Okay, so now let's proceed to learn the next punctuation. Okay, so what is the next punctuation? Let's see. It is quotation marks. Okay, now these quotation marks, I'm sure you all know that when we speak or when we are writing about what somebody else has spoken, then we use the quotation marks. So let us see where it is actually used. Okay, now it is used for direct speech. Now, for example, if you see here, Robert said, I like reading novels. Now, if you see here, even in the second one, where is Rita said the storybook? Now, here we have used single inverted commas. Now, please understand that quotation marks, either single or double, they both are right. Okay, so you can use either single inverted or double inverted quotation marks. Okay, now look at the next one, to draw attention. Now, when I want to draw attention to the word see, then I put it in quotation marks, okay, in inverted commas. In this sentence, the word see is a verb. In order to highlight it, I want to draw attention, I want to highlight this word, so I use the quotation marks. The next one, here the simple interest is rupees 450. So in order to highlight the word simple interest, that so that everybody's attention is drawn to it, I put that in quotation marks. Now see the next one, to indicate an unusual use of a word, you know, simply you have used that word may not be suitable there, or it sounds a little different there, but and therefore you have used. So to indicate or to highlight this unusual use of the word, you're using that inverted comma or quotation marks. The data might be compromised. Okay, compromised means somebody else has misused it. Okay, so you're using the word compromise, so you're putting it in inverted commas or quotation marks. Now see this, I got baked in the scorching heat. Definitely we don't get baked, but you're making an unusual use of this word, baked. So you're putting it in quotation marks. You may or may not do that. It is not necessary that you use quotation marks there, but you could use, all right. Now look at the next one, someone else's word. This is very important. These are not your words, it's somebody else's words. Then you definitely have to use inverted commas, and it would be better that you use the double inverted commas. See this, he said that the joke was in poor taste. Now whose words are these? Not my words, these are his words. Okay, in poor taste. This is not what I am saying, Baba. That is what he has said. Okay. Now the lawyers pronounced him guilty. This is what they are saying. All right. So this word is theirs. All right. So whenever it is somebody else's word that you're using, not your words, then please write or mention it that way by using the inverted commas. The double inverted is better in this case. Okay, now we are seeing the next one, that is capital letters. It is also called uppercase. If you see in computers also, it is written, if you want to make anything capital, they write it as uppercase. Okay, now where all do we use? Definitely you know that we use it at the beginning of a sentence. Okay, now see here, at the beginning of a sentence you're using, all right. They are great players. Then the school is closed today, so the word. Okay, so there you're using the capitals. Okay, fine. Let's see the next one. Now, all the examples that I'm going to give you are all about proper nouns. So, what are the various places where we use proper nouns? See this, when it's a country,
Nationality, okay. India, Indian. Russia, Russian. You use capitals. Language, okay. Marathi, Hindi, Kannada, then Telugu, all right. Then even if you say Hindi, okay, we have said that. If you want to say Bengali, Gujarati, these are all the words, these we use the capital letters, okay. Urdu, then you can also say Persian, Spanish, okay. So these are all words that are used and we use the capitals there. People's names that we already know that we definitely have to use capital letters. The other proper nouns, let's see here. Names of organizations or shops. Now, if you see even your school name or college name or any organization's name, they are written in capital letters. You start with capital letters. Very important. Okay. Then days of the week and months. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, months, January, February, etc. You use capitals. The other set of proper nouns, let's see again. Where all do we use? Festivals, okay? Diwali, Christmas, Eid, Ramzan Eid, R capital, Patati, P capital. So, festivals, then national days, Republic Day, Independence Day, these are all used, we use capital letters. Similarly, religions are used in, we use capital letters, okay? So, Islam, then Christianity, Hinduism, okay? So, we use capital letters there. Book titles, the titles of the books also we use capital letters, all right? So this is the use of, this is how we use capital letters. Now let's proceed to learn the other types. Now see colon mark. If you see colon mark, it is a double full stop used vertically. Okay, so that means what? It is definitely a big pause. Okay, but it is not the end of a sentence. It is very close to full stop, very, very close to full stop, but it is not the end. Okay, so where all do you use colon mark? Let's see. To separate two connected main clauses. You don't want to use a conjunction or you don't want to use a comma and a conjunction. So instead of that, using comma and a conjunction, you remove those two and just put a colon mark. See, for example, he won, he had to. Okay, he won, he had to, both are connected, you can separate them also and use them, but see both are connected. If you don't put them together in one sentence, they don't make sense, you don't understand that they are connected. So in order to show the connection, you put the colon mark. He won, he had to win. Okay, I was worried, this was tricky. Okay, I was worried because this was tricky. Okay, but I didn't want to use comma and because. So what do? I was worried. This was tricky. So you put a colon mark. So this gives you an indication that though they are separate sentences, they can be made into separate sentences. But if I separate them, the connection is not seen. So to show people the connection, to show the connection between the two, I put the colon mark there. Okay. Now, before a list, this is simple. This is, of course, very easy. He sold his wares. He sold the wares. What are they? Cookies, cakes, etc. Then, I like books. Which books? Fiction, classic, etc. So, you can show that before a list. Before an explanation, I want to give an explanation. So, before that, I put a colon mark. See this? It is clear. This was all a plan. What is clear? This was all a plan. Okay. Now, this is almost like this. Okay. To separate two connected main clauses. Now, this is also almost like that. Okay. It is clear. What is clear? That this was all a plan. But I don't want to use that and I don't want to use a comma. So, I'm using a colon mark. Make a model. This is the idea. So, what is the idea? Make a model. But I'm using a colon mark. They are connected, though I can separate them also, but they're connected. So I want to show the connection. So make a model. This is the idea. Okay. Next one. After headings, that we know. Okay. Now see, when we say concept of something, colon mark, it is defined as, you don't put semicolon, you put colon mark because you're saying that it is highlighted. It is separate from the rest. Okay. It is defined as whatever, whatever. See, the atom, definition of atom is put here. There is a colon mark. Okay. See the next one. In a drama script. Now, suppose in a drama script, if you want to indicate a dialogue, you put. Now, see, king is saying this, okay? I order you to punish the traitor. Now, the king is saying this. So, you put a colon mark there to indicate the king. Simba saying, now Simba is saying this in a dialogue, in a script. So, I respect my father. Okay? Now, the next one. Before the second part of a title, now suppose there is a book title or some other title for anything, then you put a colon mark because there is another part of the title coming up. For example, this is the title of the book, Mathematics, Concepts and Theories. So, Mathematics, colon mark, Concepts and Theories. You don't put a semicolon, you put a colon mark, okay? Digital India, colon mark, A Dream or Reality. So, you see, this is how we use. So, these are all the different uses of a colon mark. Very close in heels of colon mark is the next one, the semicolon. Let us understand the difference between the two. We shall now know very clearly where to use colon and semicolon. Okay. See, the semicolon is again used between two main clauses, but here, even if you separate them, they are not connected main clauses. They are not connected as it was in the previous one. They are not connected. Okay. They can stay separated also. It is connected to the context or the situation that you are talking about. But these two sentences can stay separate and still give you the meaning. Okay. Now, I'll give you an example for this. See this. It was a dark night. Okay, now all this is connected to the dark night. So, I use a colon mark. Can you see a colon mark? But what are the other things? The clouds looked eerie. The wind made weird sounds. So, see here, the clouds is different from the wind. I could have put a full stop and etc. etc. But I'm connecting the whole thing to the dark night. So, the clouds looked eerie. Semicolon, the wind made weird sounds, semicolon, the trees made scary shadows, and the moon hid him itself. Now, here since and is coming, there is nothing on either side of and. But here, you're using the semicolon because they are two disjoint sentences. Okay, they are disjoint. You can separate them. But since they are all connected to the dark night, you put a colon mark here because they are all connected to the dark night. But now, between them, there is not much connection. So, you are putting them as separate. It's kind of a list that you are showing, but you are not putting a comma. You are putting a semicolon because a semicolon is a longer pause than comma. Okay. Because there's a full stop as well as a comma. It's a longer pause than comma. Okay. Now, see here, it is used to separate items in a list, especially if the listed items are not words, they are phrases or clauses, they are groups of words. So, if there are groups of words, then you don't use comma, you use a semicolon. That is a logical thing. Okay. So, because if words, you can separate by using commas. But if they are clauses or phrases, it's better that we use the semicolon. So, see here. She cooked many delicacies. I want you to appreciate that how we are using the colon mark. See, because the rest of the sentence is connected to this. She cooked many delicacies. I don't want to separate them. All right. So, cooked many delicacies, colon mark. What are they? Dry paneer tikka. Now, you see this here. This is a phrase. All right. So, the next is also a phrase. So, I cannot put a comma. I have to use this semicolon. Okay. Spicy and hot soup, semicolon. Crunchy, comma, crisp fries. Okay, crunchy, crisp fries. Now, see here, crunchy, comma, crisp fries, because both the words are for the fries and many more. Okay, so I hope you have understood where the semicolon is used. Now, we go on to the next one. They are called the brackets. We know how the brackets are very useful and how they are used. Okay, now brackets are actually, they separate something completely because they are, you can use them to highlight and they also help you to separate a word. Okay, to show that they are separate. Brackets also called parentheses. Parentheses are these rounded brackets. Okay, they are used to enclose a word or words that add more meaning and clarity. So, you are putting that in order to ensure more clarity. For example, look at this example, the job, which job? Making bangles. Okay, so the job is hazardous. All right. So your, which is that job you're highlighting, making bangles. So you're enclosing that for greater clarity. Second one, the principal. Now you wanted to know the name of the principal. Okay. Dr. Dubey has announced the results. Okay. So you're showing who it is. The flowers, which ones? The ones growing in my backyard. Okay. Are liked by everyone. So this is how you show that, you know, you don't, you are showing that you're explaining something about the flowers, but you still want to keep them separate, are liked by everyone. You could put commas also here, the flowers, comma, the ones growing in my backyard, comma, are liked by everyone. You can do that also, but a bracket would be very nice because you're showing that it's standing out. Okay. Brackets are also used to indicate options or alternatives. For example, now see this options how I'm showing you. Any student or students. You could also use a slash. Okay. Any student in brackets S, which means either one student or many students seeking concessions will be given a fair hearing. See the second one. I can eat a banana or any other fruit. Another option when hungry. Okay. Now you must be wondering why these other brackets are here. Well, these are brackets you are using when within brackets, there are some more brackets. Okay. So when you're having brackets within brackets, then the parenthesis comes in the innermost brackets list. Then outside, you will put this either the square bracket. This is a square bracket, or you'll use the brace brackets. Okay. So see here, the square brackets and brace brackets are used to indicate an inclusion of more brackets. See this, for example, he has many electronic gadgets. Here in brackets, kitchen gadgets, which are they? Mixer and chimney. Okay, colon, semicolon. See, because it's not over. Living room gadgets, television, computer and music system. Done, finished. I'm closing this with a square bracket. So when there are brackets within brackets, then the innermost one is the parenthesis, and outside you will have the either the square bracket or you could have the brace bracket. So this is how we use the brackets. So now we proceed to learn about something which is very useful, all our dashes now. So let's see, this is the shortest dash. Hyphen is the shortest dash that we use. Okay, very, very short. To indicate the breaking of a word at the end of a sentence. Now, see here how we use. Now, whenever you are writing and, you know, you have no space to complete that word, then you put a dash there. That is called a hyphen. Okay, because why you put a hyphen? Because you're showing this word is connected. All right, it is just a broken word. Can you see here the word explanation? Okay, both the sides, you can see the hyphen there. Explanation about the topic. All right. Next one, to separate some adjectival prefixes from another word. There are prefixes. Okay, now look at this word. He is not into anti-social activities. Anti or anti hyphen social. This is a prefix, and for that we are using the hyphen. This is a recreation. If you do not put the hyphen, it becomes recreation. Okay, it is a recreation of the crime scene. All right, so you please understand this. Now, your adjectival prefixes. So, you have to use the hyphen. Okay, now let's see here, to join two or more words that together form an adjective. Where this adjective is used before the noun it describes. For example, don't worry, it's simple. See here, now this is an adjective for the work. But then, how to write this now? Up to date. That hyphen to hyphen date. Okay, you don't put up to date separate, because when you use, now suppose if I had to write this up to date later, it was okay. His work was up to date is fine without the hyphen. But now when it is coming before, you cannot understand if you do not put the hyphen. Because you put the hyphen, you read it as one word. Okay, now see this, she is a 2-year-old child. She is a 2-year-old child. Okay, now 2-year-old. Together, you're reading. Fine. Now, there's one more use. Let's see which one. See this. Now, used in compound words. I'm sure you'll be able to identify this. Now, see, daughter-in-law, 21, well-being. Well, the hyphen, in short, shows the connection between words. Okay, that they are together. They have to be read together. together. Okay, so the hyphen shows connection between two words. Okay, let's see the dash. Now here we have to understand that there are two dashes, okay, two types of dashes. One is the N dash and is the M dash, okay. Can you see here, N dash is a shorter one and M dash is a longer one. Now you would wonder, how is it different from hyphen? Well, hyphen is the shortest dash. N dash is bigger than a hyphen, M dash is the biggest. Okay, it's the longest dash. All right, now let us see what's the difference and where do we use. Now, longest dash we use especially in those cases where there are long sentences where you have to separate. Okay, so let's see here. See the M dash, it's called M because M is longer, N looks shorter. It's the longest dash, stronger than comma. To avoid brackets, it is stronger than comma. So if you don't want to put comma, you put a dash there. That is the longer dash, and you can also avoid brackets. Okay, now look at this. Because earlier I had told you that you can use comma to separate some important highlighting words. Now see, at the beginning and end of a comment that interrupts the flow of a sentence. Now look at this. Now children, Kenneth, stop talking. Now you have to have a break here. You're breaking it because you are addressing Kenneth. Okay, because your sentence is actually, now children, open your books to page 20. So in between you had to address Kenneth and tell him to stop talking. So Kenneth, stop talking. So therefore you have to use the long dash, otherwise it's not understood and you would read it together. Okay, so to indicate that these are separate, you don't want to use brackets, you don't want to use comma, you could use brackets. But then brackets would indicate that it is connected with children. Well, it is not. Okay, it's a separate statement. Okay, you're breaking off and therefore you use the long dash. See the next sentence, to separate off extra information. See this, boots and shoes, all shapes, sizes and colors. Now, I'm saying boots and shoes of all shapes, you could here use brackets also. You could use brackets also, but you don't want to use brackets, so you use these long or M dashes. That is also fine. And a long dash indicates that this is another type of sentence or extra information that is used in a sentence. So you have a choice of certain punctuations where you could use them. Okay. Now let's see where the N dash is used. The N dash is longer than hyphen but shorter than M dash. And it means through, from here to here. It shows a range. Can you see here N and M? N is smaller, the width is smaller, it's okay. And M, that is how these words have come. The why they call it N dash. It's smaller width and M is a longer width. Okay, the length is longer, N is shorter. And it means through. N dash means through. I'll show you what it means. Okay, see here, the first one, to show the range. For example, yesterday the temperature was 40 to 45 degrees Celsius. So you show here the range. Okay, whenever you're showing a range, you use the N dash. See the next one, to show from and to, from Borivali to Churchgate, from India to the US. Mumbai Chennai Express. Okay, so when from and to, it is showing through. Okay, see this. Now to show a relation between countries and groups. India China border. Now showing the relation between India and China. Indo-American. This is not a hyphen. Okay, this is not a hyphen. It is a dash. Okay, hyphen is actually used with, they are, it's actually one word, but you want to read them together, yet you're showing that they are separate. Okay, this is very clearly separate. Okay, Indo-American border or Indo-American relations, India-China border, etc. Okay, now we do the last one. We've come to the last one, that is slash, or the cutting, the slash. Now here it's very important where we use the slash. See here, I'm sure you know that slash could also mean or. Okay, see here, it is used to separate letters, words or numbers. It's also used to indicate or, alternatives, ratios, that is a division sign, and ranges, and in website addresses. See, I'm giving an example of all this. He or she or it alternatives. Here, see, 100 kilometers per hour. So this is a ratio. Kilometers per hour is a ratio. The third one, the 2018-19 accounting year. You could put a dash also here because of the N dash you can use because 2018-19 through 19, or you could use the slash. And look at this website address, http://, and the two slashes and the dots. Okay, see children or anyone who is also teaching this or teachers, please note that here the punctuations are used, the different punctuations are used. Okay, now this is how we have learned about 13 punctuations, and this is how we can understand that they have to be used in the right place, at the right place, at the right time. They have to be used in order to make complete sense and to allow us to express things in a proper and clear and meaningful manner. Okay, so thank you very much for paying attention to this topic.